Hello, and welcome to the Luminous program. My name is Father Paul Magyar, and I'm the pastor of St. Gertrude's Parish in Oshawa, Ontario, Canada. Let us begin with a prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We ask you, Lord, to please send your Holy Spirit amongst us, to inspire us to be better people, to be responsible people, to do the best that we can in our lives, to take care of our families, of our friends, and of our neighbors, and always be inspired to be the best Catholics and children of God, through Christ our Lord. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us now listen to the words from Scripture. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus called the 12 and began to send them out two by two, and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them not to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. Jesus said to them, "Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you and they refuse to hear you, as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them." So the 12 went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. In today's Gospel from Mark, we see how Jesus sends out his 12 disciples that he gathered out to all the neighboring towns and villages. This is the extension of Jesus' mission. He's now training them. He's now training the church to be good at proclaiming the good news. And what is happening here is that, you know, Jesus has been going from town to town with them. They've seen him preach, they've seen him teach, they've seen him raise, you know, for example, the dead. They've seen him cure the sick. They've seen him do a lot of miraculous things. And now it is up to them to practice what they have been taught by Christ. So they've been taught by his word. So the word, logos, the word of God, is Christ. And so Christ, the word, is teaching his disciples. And so the way he teaches them is that they're actually doing things by action. They're performing the good works by action. They're going to the different towns and places. The term for that is word made flesh. The word made flesh term has two things. First of all, the word, the logos, becomes flesh. Jesus is born, as in Christmas. But also it means that we apply what we hear, the scripture, the words that Jesus teaches us, and we apply them and we actually do the actions in our life, literally. That's what the disciples are doing. They're actually performing the good works of Christ. They're, you know, have power over the unclean spirits. They can perform exorcisms. They cure the sick by using oil. That's important because during the anointing of the sick, as a priest, when I give the anointing of the sick to a person who is dying, I give him the oil of the infirmed, similar to how this is done, especially in the early church. Now, as they're going around in their first mission, he tells them very specifically how to behave, how to act in a civilized way in society, especially as a disciple, as a representative of Christ. There's a certain way of how to act, you know, not to have too many possessions and not to move around from house to house, you know, but to be very peaceful and to walk in peacefully and walk out peacefully, even if there's rejection, because there is a lot of rejection, especially in the early church. And the disciples really have to get used to that and not get too distraught. They have to accept the fact that life is suffering. And that's an important realization. When we walk into church, one thing that we need to always notice, we see Jesus on the cross. It's right in front of us. It's right there saying, life is suffering. We sit down at the pew. What is surrounding us is the stations of the cross. The 14 stations is Jesus' suffering on his way to be crucified. We're surrounded by suffering. We're sitting in the middle of it. The altar is in the midst of this surrounding of suffering with the stations that are crossed. And it's interesting why that would be, because, well, that's the reality. We have to deal with it. You know, there's Jesus on the cross. He falls once, twice, three times. Then he gets crucified. Then he dies. And then he resurrects. There's a lot of suffering in the world. But we have to, as Catholics, realize that we need to find the meaning within that suffering, the purpose in that suffering. And we find meaning within the suffering, then we realize that our suffering is worthwhile. And we have a lot of questions, you know, surrounding suffering, especially when we know there's a lot of innocent people suffering. You know, the big question is, why do innocent people suffer? And it's because most of the time is we're suffering innocently for the sins caused by others somewhere in the world. No matter what, humanity pays for sin. You know, sin has a price, but it never reveals the price tag. We never know until the sin is committed, then somebody, somewhere in the world, pays for that sin. Not necessarily that the sinner pays for the sins. It's as if, for example, there is a sinner who poisons the water that flows into a kingdom. You know, that kingdom will suffer, but that person really doesn't. Really, at the end, at their particular judgment, then God will determine, you know, what's going to happen. But see, usually what happens is that we suffer innocently for the sins caused by others somewhere in the world. And so this is what's happening. We realize that's what the disciples are going through. They have to understand this reality and work within that framework. Because Jesus is teaching us that, you know, when you look and you see your goal, so John the Baptist, for example, teaches repentance. Jesus teaches his disciples the same thing of the importance of repentance. It flows from the teaching of John the Baptist. You know, lower the hills, increase the valleys. You know, decrease what you're doing wrong, increase what you're doing right. Keep your path straight, and you'll see your goal, the imitation of Christ. There's Christ. You know, but to get there, to achieve our goal, to the best people that we can be, to achieve that highest good, we're going to fall along the way. Several times. That's the reality of what the stations of the cross is telling us. You're going to fall and fall again and fall again. But remember, the most important thing is to get up and keep moving forward. You know, to pick up your cross willingly and carry it. That's one of the hallmarks of Christianity. We need to embrace the cross in order to move it. We have to embrace it fully, fully grab it because it's heavy, and we have to really move it along. And we have to willingly do that. And that gives our life meaning and purpose. Because it's hard. And anything that's hard, you know, we know it's on the right path. And so then we face death. And death is, you know, is something that we have to all go through in order to, of course, get to heaven. However, you know, we look at death, and death has many people look at it negatively. And we have to see, well, what is the meaning behind that? One of the greatest statues ever made in history is the Pietà. The Pietà is a statue made in the Renaissance by the great sculptor Michelangelo. It's in Rome, it's inside St. Peter's Basilica, and thousands of people each and every day go to look at it. People from all over the world come to look at the Pietà. You know, it is Mother Mary holding her dead son, Jesus. He just came off the cross, he died, she's holding him in her arms. And it's complete suffering and death. It is the mother looking at her dead son. You know, it is the worst thing possible, the worst suffering, death possible. And people come to look at it, and they're mesmerized to look at it. And it's amazing, and it's quite astonishing. And what are the people looking at? Why is it? What's drawing us to look at this statue, at this immense suffering? And we're looking at it for a long time. And the reason is because Michelangelo, the artist who made it, did something very spectacular. He was able to extract the beauty out of suffering. He was able to extract beauty out of death, meaning within the suffering, meaning within that death. You know, it is, and he puts it right in front of us. He extracts it out and puts it in front of us. That's what the people are looking at, because it's a beautiful statue, you know, and it's mesmerizing. That's, you know, that's how we reach and we extract the highest good from something that's completely dark. You know, it's like death and suffering, you know, extracting that good. That's something we practice every time we come to Mass. You know, the altar is in the center of the church, we see it, but it's in the midst, surrounded by the suffering of the stations of the cross and the cross itself. You know, the body of Christ comes from within. We are in the midst of it. You know, it's that we together with Christ in communion, you know, are the meaning within that suffering that we go through. And so, you know, this is what the disciples are trying to do. They're trying to tell people, well, you have to repent your sins. You have to follow Christ. Well, what happens when it's rejected? Well, the disciples are taught very specifically what to do. If you're a disciple of Christ, especially in Jesus' time, you cannot stay at a person's house longer than 2 days. If you stay longer than 2 days, you're actually considered to be a false prophet. So you cannot, if you stay longer than 3 days in the Hebraic tradition, you have to work for your stay. And you can only stay to a maximum of 1 month in a person's house, even if you're working for your stay. And then you have to actually move to another relative's house in that sense. And so this is what he's teaching them, is that, well, you don't want to overstay your visit. You give your best, you teach the best, and you move on forward. And what happens when you're rejected? Well, you shake the dust off your feet. That's a testimony, it's a Hebraic testimony. And we'll say you shake off the dust, it's a non-violent approach, and you keep going to where your peace is accepted. And that's what God does. If the peace is not accepted, the peace returns to you, and you give it to somebody else who can use the peace. And that's what we're looking for. We're looking for people who can open their hearts to receive the peace of Christ, can open their hearts to receive the grace of Christ. Because, you know, life is suffering, and we have to help as many people as we can within our lives. You know, we try to help our family and our friends within the life that we have. It's a great term, you know, bloom where you are planted. You know, bloom where you are planted. We're all flowers in the garden of God. You know, we bloom and we contribute to the beauty of the kingdom of God, beauty to the God's garden with every good action, with every good deed, with every good words that we say to others, you know. And so we can only work within the life that we have to the best of our ability and try to make and bring Christ and the peace of Christ to all the people in our family and friends and neighbors of our life. Let us close with a prayer. We ask our Blessed Mother to always be with us. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. The Lord be with you, and Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.